Innovation. It's not just a word, it's an action. With artificial intelligence, we are not crawling or walking or running. We are flying today. Microsoft AI helps an architect bring history back to life. He doesn't see data, he sees fragments of our past. This is now. Artificial intelligence helps farmers grow more food with less resources. She's not collecting information. She's feeding a growing population without wrecking the planet. This is real. An engineer explores how AI could help the deaf see sound. She's not looking at obstacles. She's staring down opportunity. Innovation doesn't see the possibility of tomorrow. It creates tomorrow. And are you ready for the headline? Tomorrow is here today.
Για τους περισσότερους εδώ, ο επόμενος ομιλητής δεν χρειάζεται πολλές συστάσεις. Ο Δόκτωρ Νικόλας Χριστάκης είναι μια ιδιαίτερη περίπτωση. Sterling Professor στο Yale, μέσα στους top 100 influencers, σύμφωνα με τους Times, μέσα στους top 100 global thinkers, σύμφωνα με το Foreign Policy, συγγραφέας βιβλίων bestseller, ομιλητής TEDx. Αυτό όμως που επισκιάζουν οι τίτλοι και οι αναγνωρίσεις είναι τι ακριβώς κατάφερε ο Δόκτωρ Χριστάκης και πότε. 10 χρόνια πριν έγινε παγκοσμίως γνωστός όταν απέδειξε πως το τι κάνουν, τι πιστεύουν, σε τι κατάσταση βρίσκονται οι άνθρωποι επηρεάζεται από τον κοινωνικό κύκλο στον οποίο βρίσκονται. Δηλαδή, αν οι φίλοι των φίλων μου καπνίζουν, είναι πολύ πιθανό να καπνίζω κι εγώ. Αν οι γνωστοί των φίλων μου έχουν καλές δουλειές, τότε είναι πολύ πιθανό να έχω κι εγώ. Το συγκλονιστικό σε αυτή την περίπτωση με τον κύριο Χριστάκη είναι όχι μόνο το τι απέδειξε, αλλά και το πότε. Πριν δηλαδή τα social media μπουν για τα καλά στη ζωή μας, πριν τα φαινόμενα τύπου fake news αναδειχθούν ως κυρίαρχα, πριν υπάρξει πληθώρα δεδομένων και σκανδάλων σχετικά με τα social media, ένα πραγματικά πολύ ενδιαφέρον πεδίο έρευνας.
Παρακαλώ, υποδεχθείτε στη σκηνή τον Δόκτωρα Νικόλαο Χριστάκη, Sterling Professor of Social and Natural Science at Yale University.
Σας ευχαριστώ πάρα πολύ. Θα ήθελα πάρα πολύ να μπορώ να βγάλω αυτή την ομιλία στα ελληνικά, αλλά δυστυχώς τα επαγγελματικά μου ελληνικά και τα τεχνικά μου ελληνικά δεν είναι αρκετά καλά. Και μόλις έφτασα στην Ελλάδα εχθές και χρειάζομαι τουλάχιστον 3-4 εβδομάδες πριν στρωθώ, ας πούμε, αρκετά να βολώ να εκφραστώ. Και πράγματι, άμα προσπαθούσα να βγάλω την ομιλία στα ελληνικά, θα εκνευριζόμουν και θα άρχιζα να κάνω λάθη. Λοιπόν, συγγνώμη, θα σας μιλήσω στα αγγλικά. So I'm sorry, just going to switch to English. But I want you to know at least that I can speak Greek. So humans are embedded in social networks. And these networks obey very particular mathematical, biological, psychological, and sociological rules. And if we can understand these rules, if we can understand the rules about the structure and function of human social networks, it gives us new ways to intervene in the world to make it better, to improve our health, our wealth, our security, and our civic life. Now, I'm interested in real social networks, the kind we human beings have been making for tens of thousands of years, and not just the online variety. Real social networks look like this. Every dot is a person. Every line between them is a relationship between two people. Who's whose sibling? Who's whose friend? Who's whose coworker or whose neighbor, for example? And these are real face-to-face interactions. For instance, in an early project of ours over 10 years ago, we used a network analysis to understand the role of networks in the transmission of obesity. Here is an image from that study. There are 2,000 people shown on this image. The dot size is proportional to how big people are. And the color, so bigger dots are bigger people, and the color is colored yellow if the people are properly obese. So if their body mass index is above 30, we color them yellow. And if you look at this image, you might be able to see clusters of yellow and red dots, consistent perhaps with outbreaks of obesity occurring within the network, suggesting maybe some kind of contagion, some kind of spread among individuals. But still, the visual complexity is very high here. And a number of questions are raised. How much clustering is there? Is there more clustering than due to chance? How big are the clusters? And most importantly, what might cause the clusters? So we borrowed some mathematical techniques from statistical physics, and we did an analysis that's shown on this slide. On the y-axis is the increase in the probability that a person is obese, given that a friend of theirs is obese. And on the x-axis is the degrees of separation between the two people. And what this slide shows is that on the far left, in the red bar, if your friends are obese, you've got a 45% higher likelihood of being obese yourself. And in the second bar over in the, in the far left on the purple bar, in the second bar over in the red bar, it shows that if your friends' friends at 2 degrees of separation are obese, you've got a 25% higher likelihood of being obese. And the third bar over, the orange bar, if your friends' friends' friends are obese, you've got a 10% higher likelihood of being obese. So it's only when I get to your friends' 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 friends that there's no longer a relationship between that person's body size and your body size. So if I knew nothing else about you except the body size of this person, who's almost certainly a stranger to you, your friends' friends' friends, for instance, I would be better than chance able to predict your body size. So this analysis shows us that not only is there more a relationship between people's body size than expected due to chance, if it were chance, it would be 0% across the board. There'd be no relationship between me and my friend's body size and my friend's friend's body size, first. And second, it shows that the radius of the clusters is to 3 degrees of separation. But it doesn't tell us the cause of the clusters. And there are at least three possible reasons why attributes of individuals might be related in social space. One idea is a kind of induction effect, or a domino's tipping effect. Here the idea is that as you gain weight, it makes me gain weight. As I gain weight, it makes you gain weight. There's a kind of spreading process in the network. A second idea is that it's not that, but rather that you and I form a friendship because we have a similar interest in food or a similar interest in exercise. So here it's homophily, or love of like, or birds of a feather flock together. And a third possibility is that it's neither of those, but rather that we both share an exposure, for instance, to a gym that makes us both lose weight at the same time, or a restaurant that makes us both gain weight at the same time, a contextual effect. Now, typically, all three of these are present in any social phenomenon. Why are your customers buying your products? Are they buying your products because their colleagues are buying your products? Are the technophilic, product-loving customers forming relationships with each other? Or is it your marketing campaign that's making everyone want to buy the same product at the same time? So using a variety of methods, we found that weight loss, in the case of obesity, and weight gain both can spread in human social networks. And so that if your friends or your friends' friends gain or lose weight, it affects you. And we found that there were a variety of mechanisms for this effect. And one of the mechanisms was a spread of norms between individuals. So the idea is that as your friends gain weight, it changes your idea about what an acceptable body size is. So you say, oh, it's okay to be bigger. Then you become bigger, and you pass it on to the next person. Now, actually, we found evidence for a variety of behaviors and phenomena using experiments and other methods of the spread of different attributes or behaviors beyond just obesity. And we saw that it typically spread to about what we call 3 degrees of influence. So for example, obesity, smoking, drinking, and drug use behavior. Emotional states like happiness, loneliness, depression, and altruism spread among individuals. Crime, voting behavior, purchasing behavior, and ideas. So the general point is that it's not just that when I affect you, it affects one person, it's that it ripples through the network and can affect dozens, sometimes hundreds of other people. So a key idea about social networks is that networks magnify whatever they are seeded with. If you put something into a network, it will make more of it. If you put fascism into a network, or Ebola into a network, or fake news into a network, or violence into a network, the network will make more of that thing. But equally, the network will magnify love and happiness and ideas and kindness. But it must be seeded. You have to start the epidemic going. The network does not on its own give rise to the phenomenon. So networks function as a kind of social magnifying glass. In fact, that's one reason we evolved to have them. Now, to be clear, we are affected in another way by networks. It's not just what's happening around us, whether people are using a technology, for example, that affects us. Oh, they bought a particular kind of phone, so I should buy that phone. Or they gained weight, so I'll gain weight. It's also the actual structure of the network that also matters. Think about these two objects. As you all learned in high school chemistry, they're both made of carbon. And on the left, you have graphite, which is soft and dark. And on the right, you have diamond, which is hard and clear. And there are two key intellectual ideas here. First of all, when you take the carbon atoms and connect them one way, you get one set of properties. And if you take the same carbon atoms and connect them another way, you get a completely different set of properties. And this means two things. First, these properties of softness and darkness and hardness and clearness are not properties of the carbon atoms. They're properties of the collection of carbon atoms. Second, which properties you get depends on how you connect the carbon atoms to each other. Connect them one way, you get one set of properties. Take the same carbon atoms and connect them another way, and you get a different set of properties. And it's the same with human groups. You can take a group of people, and you connect them one way, and they are productive, and innovative, and cooperative, and happy, and healthy. Or you take the same people and connect them a different way, and they are unhappy, and uncooperative, and uninnovative, and unproductive, and unhealthy. So it's not just what's going on in the network that matters. The actual structure of the network, near and far, affects our experience of the world. Now, observations like these, I just summarized like 10 years of work in 5 minutes or something like that. Observations like these suggested three broad ways to intervene in networks so as to enhance public health and public policy, and how to use social networks for good. And I'd like to quickly review some of our experiments in the last 5 or 10 years showing how you can take advantage of an understanding of networks to make the world better. And there's expanding science in all three areas. The first idea is that you can manipulate a contagion. Here the idea is you have a set of social relationships. To whom should you introduce an innovation or a germ, if you were a terrorist? Who should you infect so that if you infect that person, everyone will become infected? Or if you're a manager at a firm, who should you introduce an idea to so everyone will adopt that idea? So that's changing the flows of something within the network, a contagion intervention. A second idea is that you can manipulate connection. Here the idea is that you try to rewire the network. You try to change the structure of the network, who's connected to who, to cause desirable properties. And a third and more subtle idea, that's a new idea that we've been exploring with what we call our artificial intelligence, our AI initiative, is what we call position interventions. This is to change the location of people within a network. And the simplest example of this is that you imagine a teacher that has a classroom and has chairs that are nailed to the floor, let's say 20 chairs, and they have 20 students. So some of the students are good students and some are not good students. Where should the teacher put those students in those desks to get the most learning out of the classroom? How do you arrange the individuals? What's the position you need to put the individuals in to enhance the productivity of the group? And the same thing could apply within firms. You have 100 engineers that work for you. Where should those engineers be seated in the office so that their interactions yield the most ideas? This is an example of some of the ideas in the position class. So first we can do experiments manipulating contagion. For example, here's a paradigm of experiments that we're conducting, illustrating how you might do this in the developing world. So many of my experiments we do in developing world settings, like in Honduras or in India or in Uganda. But the ideas that I'm about to show you apply also to firms or schools or workplaces or hospitals. Imagine you map the networks of two villages on the left and on the right. Every dot's a person. The lines represent friendships between the two people. And on the right-hand village, as is shown in the yellow dots, you target those individuals with a marketing campaign to teach them, for example, how to breastfeed their children or how to vaccinate their children or a clean water intervention, some kind of public health intervention. Now, the usual perspective in public health is that you come back a year later, you go to those 6 yellow-dotted individuals, and you see what fraction of them have started doing the new thing. What fraction of them are now doing this public health practice? And you might find that 3 of the 6 are doing it. So 3 of the 6 people in that village that you targeted adopted the practice. But that's not what I'm interested in. I'm not interested in response to treatment among the treated. I am interested in response to treatment among the untreated. I want to know, what does everyone else in the village do when you give the intervention to those six people? So maybe three of the six people respond, but they persuade three of their friends to respond. So in the right-hand village, a total of six people might adopt the practice. And the left-hand village is a control village where you didn't do anything, and maybe just by chance, two people adopt the practice. So that difference between six and two is a measure of the spillover effect. It's a measure of the spread within the network. But you should have the intuition that maybe you shouldn't pick the six people at random. Maybe, for example, you should pick six people in the middle of the network, the people who are the most connected. So now these six yellow dots might be in the middle. Maybe you deliver the intervention to those six people. Once again, three of them adopt the practice, but they persuade 30 of their friends to adopt. Think about that. Same village, same intervention, same number of people targeted, 10 times the effect, because you have shrewdly and thoughtfully picked particular individuals within the network that are structurally influential, that maximize the spread within the network. So we've been doing quite a number of experiments of this. For example, we've been working in Honduras. It's a very poor part of the world. This is a little village of about 100 people, very hilly. These villages are isolated from one another. And we've been doing experiments in this type of a situation. We've developed some software that we call Trellis that allows us to map social networks in the field. And this software can now also be used in workplaces or in churches or in schools, the same software to map the networks of people. We developed this software in part to solve what we call our Maria Hernandez problem, like our Yanis Papadopoulos problem. If you go into a village in Honduras and you ask people, who's your friend? They will say Maria Hernandez. Well, which Maria Hernandez? 20% of the people in the women are named Maria Hernandez. You need to be able to uniquely identify her, and this software allows us to do that. So we mapped the villages in this experiment in 32 villages, and we randomly assigned this third of the villages, 5% of the people were chosen at random to get the intervention. In this third of the villages, 5% were chosen who had the most connections. And in this third of the villages, we used a different targeting algorithm, a more mathematically sophisticated algorithm, to pick the structurally influential individuals. And our questions were, if you want to change the whole attitude in a population, who should you target in order to do that? If you have only a certain amount of money, to whom should you market your product so that if they adopt your product, everyone else will adopt your product? What creates the most externalities, the most ripple effects for behavior change, and how can we exploit this? This illustrates how the targets might differ in one particular village. So the orange dots are 5% of the people chosen at random, and the yellow dots are 5% chosen who are the most central in the network. So you can just visually see they're different people that you would target. And this illustrates some of our most basic results from this one experiment. We've done many. On the x-axis is the days since you targeted, since you sold or marketed the product. It was free, the product. And on the y-axis is the proportion that have adopted it. In this case, it's a multivitamin initiative, a public health initiative to get people to use vitamins. And the yellow line is the top line using one particular targeting algorithm. Within 2 weeks, we could get nearly 75% of the people in this village to start adopting this new practice using our targeting approach. All right, let's look at some experiments that involve connection. In order to do this, we've also developed some other software that we call Breadboard. This is software that allows us to create temporary artificial societies of real people online. So it's integrated with various sources of online labor. You can also use it in firms. We've also integrated this with some firms around the world with their intranets. And you can recruit human beings, and they come into a virtual environment for about an hour or less, and they play some games. And then we, with a godlike view, can manipulate the structure of the network or do other interventions to test our ideas about how these things might work in real life. We've done quite a few experiments. Let me quickly show you some results. This is an experiment that involves manipulating connection. How do we connect people to each other? So here in this experiment, in the bottom, these are people, every dot's a person, the lines are relationships we specify. We draw a network that's shown in the lower left, and we recruit people and we drop them into a particular spot in the network. We introduce them to their neighbors, and we say, now you have to cooperate with your neighbors. If you're nice to your neighbors, they'll be nice to you. Something known as a public goods game. And what happens in this experiment is the blue dots are the kind people who are nice to their neighbors, and the red dots are the people who take advantage of their neighbors who are mean. And what you find is that at the beginning, on the lower left, on the far right, on the lower left, on the bottom row, about 60% of the dots are blue. So most people start out being nice to their neighbors. And then what they discover is that their neighbors take advantage of them. And, you know, I'm nice to you, but you're not nice to me. So people get pissed off, and they stop being nice. And by the end, as you see, by the hour later, multiple rounds of the game, most of the dots are red, except for a few blue dots on the edge, keeping civilization alive, you know, being nice people. In a different branch of the experiment, we randomly assign people to a different connection regime. And in that branch of the experiment, at every time step, we also gave people the power to cut or form connections with each other. Just a little bit of social fluidity, just a little bit of ability to say, no, you know, I'm not going to stay connected to you, I'm going to connect to you instead. And in that regime, cooperation persists. So the point is this: I can take you people and I can connect you one way, and if I connect you that way, you're really nice to each other. Or I can take the same people and connect you a different way, and you're awful to each other. So it's not you people that determines whether you're cooperative or innovative or productive or healthy or happy. It's the connections between you, how you've been organized, that determines these properties. Just like the carbon example, the properties emerge, the softness and the darkness and the hardness and clearness, emerge because of how you connect the people to each other, not because of who the people are themselves. Now, in a subsequent experiment, we experimentally tested how much social fluidity is needed in order to make the groups most cooperative. Here on the x-axis is how much social fluidity there is. On the far left is 0%, totally rigid network. I introduce you to your neighbors and you're stuck with them. And on the far right is 100%. Every time step, you have completely new social contacts. Constantly, the network is in fluid motion. And in between is all the percentages in between. And on the y-axis is a statistical regression estimate. You can just treat it as the cooperation. How cooperative are these groups? At the top is more cooperative, and at the bottom is less cooperative. And what you see is on the far left, in the most rigid networks, when you're stuck with your neighbors, there's low cooperation. And on the far right, if they constantly have new neighbors, there's low cooperation. And the optimal cooperativity is in the middle, when there's a little social fluidity. And this has implications for things like work groups in firms. You don't want your work groups to be too rigid, everyone is stuck with everyone else, but you don't want them to be constantly new, so no one gets a chance to know each other. And this also is similar to many kinds of social institutions we have in our society. So consider, for instance, the institution of marriage. You don't want divorce to be impossible. You don't want people, if they get married, to be stuck forever. Because if one of the person is awful to the other person, what does the other person do? They become awful too. Now you have two people, a husband and a wife, let's say, who are awful to each other. So that's not good, because neither can escape the marriage. But you also don't want divorce to be too easy. So every day you have a new wife, for example, because you would never make an investment in your partner, right? It can't be that you have a new spouse every day. You want an institution that puts you in the middle range, that makes divorce difficult but not impossible, right? So that optimizes the cooperation and the willingness of people to invest in each other. I'm going to skip this experiment, and then I'm going to close with one experiment that we've done that involves artificial intelligence, and then with one big idea. Because I'd like to look at some experiments that involve position. And this is a line of work that also intersects with some of our very new work on artificial intelligence and the addition of bots, online bots like autonomous agents, and also physical robots like autonomous vehicles or robots in factory floors that are helping with manufacturing, to create what we call hybrid systems of humans and machines. So they are systems neither just of humans nor just of machines, but hybrid systems where humans and machines interact on a level playing field. This is a very recent experiment that we just published a couple of years ago, and it's a complicated experiment, but I'd like to walk you through it because I think the key idea is very relevant to the conference that we've had today at the Microsoft Summit. So in this experiment, using our software, we took 4,000 people and we dropped them into 230 groups. So there were groups of about 20 people. And the people were dropped into a network as shown in the upper left, and every dot's a person, and the lines represent relationships between the two people. And the groups, and everyone was randomly assigned one of three colors, yellow, orange, and purple. And they were told, you're gonna play this game for 5 minutes, and as often as you want, every second, or however often you want, pick a color, and your job is to pick a color that's different than your neighbor's. And you can only see your own neighbor's colors and your own color. If all of you work together, if you coordinate your efforts and you all work together to, by the end of the 5 minutes or sooner, have colored this graph, have every one of you has a different color than your neighbor, you will all be paid. But if you do not succeed in working together, you get no money. So the team has to work together to solve a problem. If they work together successfully and solve the problem, they get paid, otherwise they get nothing. So at every given moment, people look at their neighbors, they see, oh, I have a conflict with my neighbor, he and I have the same color, I need to change my color. So for example, if you look at the upper left, there's a node on the far left there, a little circle that's orange, and you can see that he's connected to another orange dot, and the red line between them indicates that they have the same color, that they are in conflict, and then he's connected by a blue line to a yellow dot, there's no conflict there. And you should see that that orange dot that's up at the upper left there at around 9 o'clock, what that dot should do is change to purple. If that dot changes to purple, there'll no longer be a conflict with his neighbors. So people look around and they start changing their colors. They're making the optimal choice that they can make. The bottom graph shows on the x-axis is the time from 0 to 5 minutes in seconds, and on the y-axis is the number of conflicts in the whole group. How many total conflicts are there? And there are two kinds of conflicts. There are conflicts that we call resolvable conflicts, where the individual can actually make a choice that changes the color, like the example I just gave you, or irresolvable conflicts, where the individual is stuck. If they switch to purple to solve the problem over here, now they have a purple neighbor here, they'll be in conflict over there. And so we count the number of conflicts across time, and as you can see at the beginning, there are 11 or 12 different conflicts. 11 of them are resolvable conflicts in yellow, and one of them is an irresolvable conflict. And by 105 seconds, all the conflicts, the group has worked together to solve the problem, except in the middle, there are two yellow dots that are no longer able to make a move because they're stuck. Either both of them is connected to orange and purple dots, so if they switch their yellow dot to eliminate the conflict between the two yellows, they'll increase the conflict with other individuals. This is an irresolvable conflict that's shown down below there. So one of them has to do something that seems stupid. One of them has to do something that seems irrational. They have to switch from yellow to another color to increase the conflicts. And if they do that, they unlock the potential of the whole team to find a solution. And that's what happens. And by 245 seconds, the team has colored the graph and they've solved the problem. Now, because we are sneaky, what we did in this experiment is in some of the hundreds of groups that we made, we replaced some of the people with bots. So we made a mixed system, a hybrid system of humans and machines, and some of the people were no longer people, they were just bots. And these bots were programmed with what we call dumb artificial intelligence, very simple AI. So their programming was, at every second and a half, pick the color that's in least conflicts with your neighbors, and occasionally make a random error, occasionally deliberately make a mistake. That was our insight, was to add a little noise to the system. And we experimentally manipulated where in the network did we put the bots. Did we put them in the middle of the network, or did we put them in the periphery of the network, or did we put them randomly in the network? And this is a complicated slide, but I'll explain to you what the findings are. So on the x-axis is time, so number of seconds since the game was solved. And on the y-axis is the proportion of the groups that have not solved the problem. And the orange lines represent human-only groups. So if you look, for instance, in the lower right square, you can see that at the beginning, 100% of the human groups had not solved the problem. And then the orange line shows across the 5 minutes, by the end, 65% of the human groups had solved the problem. But then we manipulated the addition of bots. So on the rows, the top row, we put the three bots at random. In the middle row, we put the three bots in the middle of the network. In the bottom row, we put the three bots on the edge of the network. And we manipulated how noisy the bots were. How much deliberate mistakes did the bots make? 0% noise is the first column, 10% noise is the second column, and 30% noise is the third column. And if you look in the middle square, you see that when we added the bots, the purple line in the middle square, when we added slightly noisy bots that made a few mistakes deliberately into the middle of the network, we were able to get the groups of people to perform better. So the addition of these bots helped the people to help themselves. So groups of people are stuck. They're not able to solve the problem. But the bots don't have to be smart. The bots don't have to know what to do. The bots just have to make it possible for the humans to do what they're supposed to do. In fact, adding bots that are deliberately wrong, bots that occasionally make mistakes, is very helpful in this situation. And so one of the key ideas here is that these bots, in my laboratory, we now are exploring a variety of other ways of designing and adding simple bots to all kinds of other situations, like how do we get people to coordinate or cooperate or evacuate? Are there ways to get groups of people to leave a building fast and effectively? Or navigate on a highway? How should groups of people that are all going somewhere, what if we add some autonomous vehicles with particular kinds of programming? Can we reduce traffic accidents and reduce congestion in cities? Or sharing in a firm, how do we get people to share useful information? Maybe all we need is just a little bots in the group to optimize sharing. And we're exploring different kinds of simple programming, what we call dumb AI, that might make this more effective. So this is some of the ideas about classes of problems of groups of people who want to do well but aren't able to do so. And these bots can also be used to address other sorts of social problems, for example, combating inequality or racism online. So the key idea here is that we are not focused on developing super smart AI to replace human cognition. We are developing dumb AI to supplement human interaction. We are trying to get the bots to help the humans to help themselves. So I'm not interested in how you interact with a bot or a robot or a machine. I'm interested in how your interactions with a machine changes your interactions with other humans in a hybrid system. How can we optimally program our AI not only to meet the needs of the users, but also to meet the needs of whole groups of people, among which are some people interacting with the AI? So I'm going to close with one final idea. And this has to do with what it means when we intervene in social networks. Because I think such interventions provide us a way to manipulate what's known as social capital. And to get one sense of this, consider this idea. What's the point of a connected life? How does it help us as individuals and as a species? Now, it turns out that networks are a resource that we can all use. Networks are a kind of social capital. And most people, when they think about capital, think about money. But really, capital is any stock of resources that you can put to productive use. Capital is a stock, something you can do something with to make something else with. And two further key ideas about capital are that in order to create capital, you have to invest skill and effort. You have to know something and do something in order to make capital. And second, and very subtle, that in order to create capital, you have to make changes in a substance that make it yield a higher rate of return than it otherwise would. That at its core, everything you heard today about creating wealth in organizations and increasing productivity is about changing those organizations. You have to manipulate those organizations to make them more productive, to make them a reservoir of wealth. So, very subtle idea that capital creation is about manipulating the natural world. Now, there are various ways you can think about this. For example, this is an idea. You take a forest, you invest skill and effort, and you convert the forest to a farm. And the farm is more valuable than the forest because you can do things with a farm that you couldn't do with a forest. Namely, grow fruits and vegetables and grains. And that's what makes the farm a reservoir of wealth and a stock of productive power. Or you can take this tree and you can invest skill and effort and mill the tree into lumber. and the lumber is more valuable than the tree because you can do things with the lumber you couldn't do with the tree. Namely, invest still more skill and effort and convert the tree into a violin. And the violin is more valuable than the lumber. You can convert the lumber into a violin. And the violin is more valuable than the lumber because you can do things with a violin you couldn't do with a lumber, namely make music. So at each step of the way, you transform the natural world, you convert one thing into another thing, and that's what makes it a reservoir of wealth and a source of productive power. Now, in the 1960s, a key innovation took place, and social scientists began to think about human beings this way. So you can take this lazy, dissolute, former graduate student of mine on the far left, who's a drunkard, and you can invest skill and effort and clean him up. And so now he's not a drunkard anymore. And now he's capable of doing things he wasn't previously able to do. And you can invest still more skill and effort and give him an education. You can work on the neurons of his mind. You can invest skill and effort to teach him things, and that's what makes him a reservoir of wealth and a source of productive power. This is what we mean when we speak about human capital. Well, just like physical capital is created by a change in the material world, and human capital by a change in persons, social capital in organizations, in companies, in communities, in villages, in fact, in our whole society, is a change in the relations among persons, a change that renders the group more productive and capable of doing things it was not previously able to do. And that is the deepest account I can give you of what social networks mean for our lives and why it is and how it is that we can use them to make the world better. Thank you.
Κύριε Χριστάκη, ευχαριστούμε πολύ. You understood this in Greek, right?
Άμα θέλετε, μπορούμε στα αγγλικά. Ή στα αγγλικά,
όπως θέλετε. No, but I wanted to ask you, I was intrigued by what you said about, we talk today about the human to machine, but you talked about the human to human connection.
Yes.
And it intrigued me a lot.
Yeah, so I mean, there are many examples of this. Today we've been hearing about all these innovations at Microsoft, products that they offer, which can be very valuable. But when we design those products or use those products, we also have to think about how they affect the whole workplace, for example. And the simplest example of this might be the use of a digital assistant. So many people will buy a digital assistant, and the people who sell the digital assistant don't program the digital assistant so that it requires you to be very polite, right? You don't say, please, Alexa, would you do me a favor and play a song? Oh, thank you so much. No, you just say, play a song, and you're rude to the machine, for example. Well, the people who design that design it deliberately to be obedient, and they would not, you wouldn't buy a product that required you to be very particular in how you talk to it, would annoy you. But the problem is that machine might teach you to be rude. So if your children are using that machine, then they get used to speaking rudely, then they go to the playground and they speak to other children rudely. So this machine is affecting how we interact with other people in this hybrid system of humans and machines. So that simple example, there are many examples like that. As we introduce this technology in our midst, what I'm interested, for example, is not how Garry Kasparov plays with Deep Blue. That's interesting and great, but what I'm interested in is how does Garry then play chess with other humans once he's played with the machine? And maybe the way humans play chess has been changed with each other, has been changed by the existence of this artificial intelligence. And I think that is a growing area of concern that's not getting the attention it deserves.
Thank you very much. Is there anything else you're working on?
Well, we're working on, yes, we're working on lots of initiatives on how to optimize artificial intelligence, physical bots and online bots, to take advantage of these ideas to make the world better. But we're very worried that these same ideas, of course, could be weaponized. So instead of, our objective is to increase the productivity of people and increase the productivity of groups. But you can imagine our enemies using this technology to degrade our cooperativity, to make us less friendly with each other. So we're also beginning to think about countermeasures, staying one step ahead of our enemies.
And you told me there's a book coming out in Greece, right?
Yes. Το βιβλίο προσχέδιο θα εκδοθεί.
Right.
Εκδοθεί αυτοκάτοπρο το φθινόπωρο και θα επιστρέψω τότε να το ζητήσω.
Thank you very much.
Ευχαριστώ πάρα πολύ.